Welcome back to The Big Picture. My guest is Steve Boyd, and we're talking about the Catholic Church, the scandal, Bishop Malone, and all things that have been happening lately. It's a broad topic, and there's a lot of different aspects, a lot of different ways to look at this. People who are Catholic, sometimes they're worried about the effect that this is going to have on their faith in general, on the way they can participate in the church. Obviously, there's a financial impact on the Catholic Church, certainly in this diocese. And the last thing that you know, we were talking during the break, the last thing that I would want to see is that the church, which stands for good and for faith and morals, to be weakened. Because society really needs that kind of influence today more than ever, really. And so this kind of scandal is a shame. It needs to be addressed, but it would be a shame if it had a negative effect on the church in general.
It would, but Jesus tore down a temple once. Sometimes it has to be torn down. And the reality here is that Bishop Malone and in many ways the church itself have lost credibility with the flock. Now, how do you build credibility? How do you build trust? One of the things that Bishop Scharfenberger, who's going to be the apostolic administrator for the next few months, said, I can't ask you to give me the trust. I have to go earn it. And so if the church goes and earns the trust, then the church will survive and the church will thrive. But one thing we've learned throughout the last 2 years in this crisis, cover-up ain't going to cut it. That's not going to be the way through. The cover-up creates more pain for the survivors. It creates more credibility problems for church leadership. What I saw in Bishop Scharfenberger's first news conference was a man who was humble, who was human, who acknowledged the pain of the survivors, acknowledged the importance of handling these cases carefully, but handling them has in the past been protect the priest. It has to also include protect the children, protect the former children who are now adults who are broken by this.
Okay, so if you were the bishop coming in, what would your first action be? How would you differ from, I know you just said, protect the children. How does that translate? What would you do specifically to change the way things have been handled?
Well, a number of things. First of all, I think it is apparent to me that since the Vatican has ordered bishops around the country to keep these secret files, that those secret files should be released so that we can see exactly what they were doing, so that we can know, so that the survivors can know. If I were abused in 1970, I would feel terrible about that abuse, right? And it could break me. If I found out that they knew about it since 1960, that's another betrayal. They don't get to cover that up. And in the civil lawsuits from the Child Victims Act, they won't be able to cover that up. So I would say, let's be as transparent as we can possibly be. They've been working for years to hide the funds, get rid of the funds. They've been telling parishes, if you needed a driveway or a roof, pay for it now, because we don't want this money sitting around when the lawsuits start. So I would say, you just need to, you have to have an honest heart. You have to be able to say what's right and what's fair. And we're not talking about the CEO of Enron. We're talking about somebody who was called to the priesthood, somebody who's devoted their lives to God, to the Bible, to the commandments. And there are 10, not 9. So you can't lie. You can't get up and say, oh, nothing is imminent, when you know you've just handed over your letter of resignation. You can't say, oh, I just retired, when you were just forced to resign. The truth, Phil, is not a movable object. The truth just is. You know where I learned that? I learned that at St. Martin's Roman Catholic Church at the corner of Abbott and Downing in South Buffalo. They taught me what the truth was, and you know what else they taught me? They taught me how to apologize. You know what an apology is? It's a little more than I'm sorry. An apology is, here's what I did. here's why it's wrong, and here's how I'm going to make it right. And that is not the apology that these survivors have received from our former bishop.
How many of these survivors do you represent?
We've represented 100 that have filed lawsuits in Supreme Court in Buffalo. About 100 more that are ready to go, a little more than 100 more that are ready to go, and about 100 in Rochester.
Okay. Part of the equation is financial.
Yep.
What about punishment for the priests who are still alive, even if it's an old case, you know, something that happened in the 70s or the 80s or the 60s? Should priests be subject to criminal prosecution and go to jail?
Well, some states have lifted the statute of limitations, so Pennsylvania is going to have no statute of limitations on the criminal side. So if you think about it, though, in the criminal arena, the burden of proof is beyond a reasonable doubt. So if you're tipping the scales, it's a big tip, right? Mm-hmm. In the civil arena, it's more likely than not. So I think it would be extremely hard for a district attorney to prosecute a case from 1965 when witnesses are gone, the priest may be dead. So I don't think you would ever see those old cases resurrected in the criminal arena. But what the Child Victims Act has done is it has given people a window to bring their claims, and then the window will close on August 13th of next year in the civil world. And for future abuse, for anybody who is being abused today, instead of having until the age of 23 to tell somebody about it and have there be criminal charges, now it's 28. In Pennsylvania, there's no age limit.
That's an interesting point. You're a lawyer, and you know the difference between civil and criminal in terms of burden of proof.
Yep.
Explain to us what the differences are when you are in a civil trial as opposed to a criminal trial. How much does emotion have come into it? How much absolute truth or proof do you have to have in a civil trial as opposed to a criminal trial? Can you just appeal to the emotional part of it? I'm glad you asked that because
the difference is, you know, in criminal, as I said, it's beyond a reasonable doubt. Right. That's a high burden, but you have police departments and, you know, state's attorneys general and the FBI and other law enforcement agencies, the DEA, you know, staffed to produce an investigation that would bring that kind of proof.
And there's nothing like that
in the civil
to go back to in the civil.
And you in the civil, the burden is different. If you pictured the scales of Lady Justice and it's you versus me, and you have the burden, you're the plaintiff, I'm the defendant, and you tip the scales in your favor slightly, you win. It's the preponderance of the evidence, the legal term. Mm-hmm. In other words, if I put a tennis ball on this set and I tip the set ever so slightly so that the ball moved, the person who tips it wins. So it is a lower burden, but you can't just use sympathy to your question. Because you have to have proof. And if you don't have actual evidence, you don't even get to trial.
So if it comes down to somebody saying, I had this childhood experience, this priest was there, we can prove that he served in that position at that time when I was there, but that's the point, that's it. Does that constitute a weak case, or can you make a case out of that?
We could make a case out of that, but there would be other factors involved, right? So one of the things we look at is, how does our client present? Mm-hmm. Does our client look like someone that a jury can believe? Mm-hmm. Who's the perpetrator? Are there 15 other cases against this perpetrator? Do the dates line up? We look at all these factors because we don't want to invest our time and energy if the case is not a real case, right? But I have to tell you, as these folks have come in, I believe probably 99.9% of these folks, because it is so hard to come forward.
I'm sure the stories are riveting, and it can't be easy to come with these stories. It's got to be traumatic when things like that happen to you when you're such a young, influenced child.
Right, and the justice system is authorized by the Constitution, right? So the Sixth Amendment handles criminal. The Seventh Amendment gives people the right to sue for money and only money. We can't give a person their childhood back. We can't give a person the years that they spent as an alcoholic or as a drug addict or the divorces they went through, the other mistakes they made in their lives because they were broken. I had a man come into my office to say I was a straight-A student. I was an altar boy. And this happened to him. He was on the right path until this happened to him. And he ended up going to jail for something he did. It breaks people.
Tragedy. Yeah, there's no winners in this. This is a sad thing. I don't envy you in the job that you have to do, because there's a lot of angry people on both sides. It's not a pleasant situation. Hopefully justice is served.
And one of the things that the diocese did do right in this process is they made counseling available to people. Mm-hmm. And I was told we were one of the only firms that do this. We ask every client if they want to take advantage of that counseling, mm-hmm. because the counseling works. Mm-hmm. There really is healing to be had. So even if we can't give you back your childhood, and even if we can't give you back your life, maybe on the path you were meant to be on, you can mm-hmm. still heal. You can still get better.
Well, we're out of time. As usual, it goes by quickly. I'd like to thank Steve Boyd for being my guest on The Big Picture. This is a show that you get a little bit of depth on. We can give it half an hour, where the other stations can give you 3 or 4 minutes to discuss this. Hopefully you enjoyed it, and it gives you something to think about. Thank you for watching The Big Picture, and thank you, as always, for watching WBBZ-TV. We'll see you next time on The Big Picture.